All right. We're going to go back, into the archive of emails here. All right, this review, well, okay, let's start at the beginning. Let's start out at the very beginning. Hello, everyone, and welcome to my channel. My name is Dr. Ray. I have this lovely channel, my little nutrition nation filled with my little nutrition soldiers, where we take pet food and we kind of demystify it. And what do I mean by demystifying? I mean we are stripping it of the marketing mumbo jumbo that honestly confuses people. And I think it does that on purpose. And it makes people sit at their computer and go through the internet and watch videos hours on end, which I always welcome you binge watching my videos. Hello, my name is Dr. Ray. I have some wonderful playlists. Feel free to binge watch them, like and subscribe. But it is not, it never used to be a thing. You know, it was never a thing before the internet where people would sit and toil and chew their fingernails off and have a horrible time machinating over pet nutrition. And I'm happy to discuss pet nutrition with you guys. You guys asked me that question. That's why I have this channel. But it shouldn't be stressful. So on my channel, I want to be fun. We are going to encourage a community of conversation. We are going to be friendly towards one another. We're going to have a good time. We're going to joke around, and we're not going to make it, you know, so uptight and cringeworthy that, you know, you dread doing it. And so, hello, welcome to the channel. I hope you enjoy what we are going to do today. I am entertaining questions from subscribers, and so that's where I get the pet review questions that I have. So I'm not sponsored. Nobody pays me to do this. If I did, I would let you know. But basically, I entertain questions from you guys. And so today I want to entertain a question from a subscriber about Jinx puppy food. And she actually did the majority of work for me, which is awesome because I do practice five, sometimes 6 days a week. And so I appreciate that this information was sent to me because it makes me easy, makes it easy for me to break the food down for you. Okay, so let's see what we have here. So she did the Jinx Puppy Food Organic Chicken and Sweet Potato Kibble. She said she worked through my PSS system. If you're not familiar with this channel or you're just becoming familiar, what I have done in order to make it simplified, and maybe some people, and I do get critiques sometimes that maybe I've oversimplified that, but that's for a reason. I take a few parameters that I think that are important. I think that this provides a solid, firm foundation. Some people may choose to stop at this solid, firm foundation. Some people may choose to go above and beyond and start looking at secondary factors. But on this firm foundation, I'm evaluating some of the key nutrient parameters. I am evaluating the life stage. I'm evaluating some of the major characteristics, and I'm evaluating whether or not they're suggesting feeding the appropriate amount. And so that's the PSS system. I'm scoring foods on a scale from 1 to 10. I'm pretty generous. I consider that if they get a 7, 8, 9, or 10, very good. I would go on to evaluating some of the secondary parameters. If they score below that, I think there's a lot of other maybe good options that you might want to explore first. And so I am not making food recommendations. I am simply teaching you how to look past the marketing and evaluate the food for yourself. So I also get a lot of questions about what food should I feed, what do you recommend, and I'm not doing any of that. I am not suggesting a medical management of your pet's nutritional condition, just teaching you how to read the labels. So if you need help reading the labels, just like this subscriber did, feel free to leave in the comments what you would like me to review. So she went ahead and did it. She used the point scoring system and she evaluated it for a large breed puppy, and she wants to compare her findings to my findings. And so we're gonna go based on what she has found. If you want to follow along at home, the website is thinkjinx.com. Let's see what options we have. They've got dry dog food, wet treats, food toppers, food bundles. We are looking for, she said that it was the puppy. Was it this one, the chicken, brown rice, sweet potato? All right, so if you select that food and then you go down and you look at their little tabs here, you've got the recipe details, and basically all this is marketing mumbo jumbo stuff here. So organic chicken as a first ingredient. First ingredient is a thing. People ask me about first ingredient all the time. Ingredient lists are heavily manipulated. They're based on weight and not volume. And so a good visual that I try to share with you guys is when you're thinking of the ingredient list and you say, okay, the number one ingredient, that means it's the most. No, it means it's the heaviest. And so think of two glass jars. In one glass jar, you have a really heavy item, and that would be like a lead fishing weight. And that one lead fishing weight only fills the very bottom of the mason jar. And then in the other mason jar, it's filled with something like, let's say, cotton. Cotton weighs very little. And that fills the entire volume of the mason jar. If it's what you're in your head, you're thinking, oh, well, if I'm putting these in the ingredient list, the first ingredient would be that cotton because that's the most. That's not the case. What the ingredient list is actually telling you is what's the heaviest. So it was actually putting that lead fishing weight first. And so they manipulate that ingredient list on purpose because it's easy for them to do. And somebody a way long time ago decided, hey, we can really do something easy because it's on the package and we can really manipulate consumers if we say, look at that first ingredient, because we can put an ingredient really heavy with water and not actually put a lot of the ingredient, but just make it go to the front of the list because it's heavier. And so I don't like playing that game. I don't want you to play that game either. So that's why I don't put a whole lot of weight on the ingredient list, because it's manipulated. And it would be very hard to get down for the average consumer down to the bare bones of it. We would really have to do some digging and maybe visit the plant. We'd have to, you know, not pay attention to all the marketing stuff and all of the promotional material. And so that's very hard to do. So I just eliminate that out of the equation. It may be part of the secondary equation where you're digging a little bit deeper. But at this very baseline approach, I'm not even going to worry about it or put the extra time and effort to go do all that digging until I know if the nutrients are actually there. So this recipe details thing, really is nothing. It does say it has calcium and phosphorus for strong bones and teeth, which is important, but it's interesting they put that there because a lot of companies overdo the calcium phosphorus. So maybe this is alluding to the fact that they know that that's important and they're going to pay attention to it. And I hope that that's the case. Again, next thing, the ingredient list. We've got them all listed there. You can, you know, go through that at your leisure. I am not going to do that. Then we've got the guaranteed analysis, and the subscriber, because she watches all my videos, knows that although this guaranteed analysis is great that they put it on there, it is missing a lot of the important things. And it's also a minimums and maximums. So she did the right thing. She emailed the company and she got this information on a dry matter basis. So good for you. And she had it, the actual typical analysis. So we've eliminated the minimum and maximum. So we're gonna go with her numbers today. So everybody should say a big thank you to Erica for doing this for us. Round of applause for Erica. And so we're going to put Erica's numbers up here today, and we're going to evaluate them both against the puppy and the large breed puppy. She did her evaluation specifically on large breed because that's what she was interested in. We're going to do our evaluation on the regular puppy because it doesn't specifically say large breed puppy on the package. The calories are 377 per cup. We're going to need that to calculate the feeding guide later on. Now, I do want to find the actual AFCO statement. Here it is, because she evaluated, but she didn't tell me what it said. So we're gonna go ahead and start there. The Jinx Puppy Chicken Brown, White, and Sweet Potato recipe is formulated to meet the nutritional levels for AFCO for all life stages, including the growth of large sized dogs. So on the PSS system, they get a point if the food is feeding trialed, which this one was not, so they do lose a point there, and they get a point if it is the correct life stage. Now, Erica went ahead and gave them a point for the correct life stage because she is feeding for a large breed puppy. If you are not and you are feeding for a regular puppy, not a large breed, which is a dog that's going to be greater than 50 or 70 pounds when it's mature, you're going to lose a point here. So let me grab my pen and paper. We're gonna do our own tally here. Let's find, we've got a lot of pages we've used here, so let's find a page. So we're gonna large breed and regular. So they're gonna get, lose a point on both of them for the formulation and not the feeding trial, but large breed puppy's gonna get a point. Regular puppy is not gonna get a point. All right, so let's keep going on. The next thing that she evaluated was the ingredient list, but not, you know, not going crazy with it. We're just making sure it's not grain-free or raw. Those are just for the general population, things that we want to avoid and may be appropriate for certain pets. And that would be, on the advice of your veterinarian, those things should not be done lightly. They should be done, in a proper setting, sometimes by a boarded nutritionist, maybe able to help you navigate. That's not really a beginner level thing to do. So she rightfully checked that to make sure it was not grain free or raw, and it wasn't. So they both get a point on both the puppy and the large breed puppy for that. So now we're gonna go into Erica's analysis using the parameters that were provided to her from Jinx. So I'm gonna pull up both my regular puppy and large breed puppy charts. Okay. So protein level, Jinx told her that this diet was 30% protein. For the regular puppy formula, we want it between 22 and 35. For the large breed, we want it between 20 and 32. And so we're each gonna get a point there for the protein. Fat at 15.6%, we're gonna be okay for the puppy, regular puppy. It's gonna be a little bit over for the large breed. The reason why, you will see that some of the nutrient parameters are actually less on the large breed puppy than the regular puppy, which may seem counterintuitive. You think bigger dog, bigger breed, it needs more. No, we do not. We want the growth to be actually a little bit slowed down on these guys so that we do not get bone growth and bone development issues. The faster a puppy grows, kind of like haste makes waste, if that makes sense. If you're giving a large breed puppy too many nutrients, the body just wants to grow really, really fast. And when it does that, it does it very sloppily, and you get bone defects and growing pains, pan osteitis, etc. Various other conditions. And so actually large breed puppies, the nutritional parameters are kind of truncated. So it's actually off on the fat for the large breed puppy. Then we have fiber, which is a give me for both regular puppy and large breed, because there's not really an established standard for that. There's a lot of leniency, so they're each going to get a point for that. And then we get into the minerals. And so they already kind of were talking about minerals earlier, so I'm really hopeful that these are going to be okay. Calcium at 1.3 is going to be good for the puppy and a little bit off on the large breed puppy. And then the phosphorus at 1.6 is going to be off on the regular puppy and off on the large breed. So that's that. Now let's do the calculation for the feeding guide. She calculated her pet's resting energy requirement. So she went ahead and watched that video and she did it. She said her dog's resting energy requirement is 1,566, and it suggests that she feeds 4 cups per day, and the calculations for that were correct. This food calculated out to 1,508, and so they're going to get a point on each of these for the resting energy requirement feeding guide. Now, how do you do that? You can watch that video. Basically, the resting energy requirement is a calculation that's not made up. It's the body weight in kilograms to the exponent 0.75 times 70, and that gives you a number, and depending on how old your pet is, that is gonna determine how much of a multiplier you use. And so puppies do require a multiplier. I'm gonna flash this chart up there. It is a bit of a calculation, but it is very simple to do. And if you wanna get into that in more detail, you can go ahead and check out that video. We're not gonna do it today for time's sake, but that video is there for you if you would like to learn how to do it. So let's tally this up. So that brings it up to a 7 out of 10 for a large breed puppy. So that's pretty good. And then actually to feed it to a regular puppy is gonna be a little bit less. It only came up to a 6 out of 10 if you're feeding this to a regular puppy, because it was off on the life stage was not appropriate, and then we were off on some of the minerals. And so there you have it. That's Jinx. It seems like this could be a pretty good option for people, especially for a large breed puppy. It was off a little bit on the minerals, so I will say the bulk of the deductions here did come on the minerals, being off on the calcium and the phosphorus. The calcium was off ever so slightly, 1/10 of a point, but it is percentages, so that does make a big difference. And then the phosphorus was quite a bit off. And so you know, definitely keep that into consideration. I would say that you may even bump this up to an 8 out of 10. And the reason being is in small animal clinical nutrition, which is the textbook we use where we have gleaned these standards from, there are two chapters on there. One of the chapters does list the fat going up to, I believe, 17%. And then in one of the later chapters, as a discussing some of the bone development issues, it does suggest this lower fat of 12%, and so I went with the more tailored version of the 12%, but there is some published data that you could go a little bit higher. So I think pretty good option Jinx is providing here for the puppy. So you may want to check that out and see if that is a good option for you. I really do thank Erica for emailing me and chatting with me back and forth and really learning how to do this for herself, because, you know, what do they say? Give a man a fish, they eat dinner. Teach a man the fish, you know, they eat for a lifetime. And that's what I want for you guys. So I hope you learned something today. I hope you enjoyed. I hope you will stay and be part of my Nutrition Nation. And like and subscribe and do all those things. And we will hang out again next week on Thursday. Bye.